Dr. Loraine Leeson is a visual artist, particularly known for her 1980s cultural campaigning in support of the communities of London's Docklands, at London, obviously, UK, and subsequent collaborative and participatory work in East London. In 2011, she was a Fulbright Scholar in Residence at the University of Washington and is currently Senior Research Fellow at the University of Westminster. She has also recently developed a new MA in Art and Political Practice at Middlesex University. Loraine is a director of the arts charity C-Space, where her work with young people has attracted a Media Trans-Inspiring Voices Award and Olympic Inspire Mark. Her public artwork in the Catch Involving 300 Children, College and University Students was voted a 2012 London Landmark. Current and recent projects include Active Energy, an arts engineering collaboration with seniors group The Geezers, developing tidal technology along the River Thames, and Lambeth Floating Marsh, with scientists addressing issues of biodiversity in urban rivers. Loraine Leeson.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. We can't remember when we first made contact, but my certain memory is when Carol came to interview myself and my then partner Peter Dunn. What attracted us is that we were all very committed to social change. We were all working towards social change through our work, and then found a most extraordinary parallels, which actually now I'm sort of looking back, I can't quite believe the parallels. They are the people who Peter and I were closest to in the whole world in terms of reasons for doing what we do and also the way we do it. I mean, there are differences, there are clear differences, but I've been back and forward to Toronto I don't know how many times now, mainly thanks to these guys, and sat at their dining table, and I'm so privileged to have done that because I feel that this is been the biggest connection for me in terms of my work and finding a context to talk about it and to find like minds. So Toronto has become a special place for me, and I'm very delighted to be here, and thank you for inviting me. So, as I said, the first time I remember meeting, it was Carol, first of all, in the flesh, was when Peter and I were working with others with the action groups and tenants associations in the London Docklands in the early 80s. It was 1982, and we were putting up our first photo mural in Wapping, East London. And Carol was there to photograph it, but it was the most momentous occasion that she just turned up at that moment. So we, like they, found that the most effective way of working, if we wanted to make a difference, was to work with the people who really know. So we were working, I would say, as the cultural arm of a campaigning community, a very highly organized campaigning community that spent 10 years organizing around the London Docklands, which, if those of you who've been to London probably know now, Canary Wharf and that whole area has been taken over. It was sold to developers under the Thatcher government. And we had been working with the trade unions in that area for some time around mainly health issues. And they had invited us to come and do a poster. And we used the means of production that we had access to. So we used photography, and we combined images, and we made complex photographic images like some other people you know. And we discovered we set up a committee for this group, the Docklands Community Poster Project, which was comprised of representatives of these tenants and action groups who met once a month to decide what needed to be said. Because we had, I think, convinced them through the work that we've been doing for a number of years over the health issues, that actually using the arts was a powerful way of getting your message across. So we felt privileged that they would come to our table and sit around and decide what needs to be said. and would trust us to be able to represent that. And so when we discussed the images, people, other artists used to say, well, isn't it like design by committee? You know, the lowest common denominator. And actually, no, it was completely the opposite. It was the best energy you can imagine, because everyone was bringing their best skills. They weren't telling us how to make images. We weren't telling them what the issues were. We were all bringing our knowledge together and making images and making arguments that we couldn't make on our own in the same way. Then, extraordinarily, and I've picked out a few, almost at random, some of Karen Carl's images. And when I pick them out, normally I'm not showing the whole sequence, but you know when I show one of their images, there is another sort of 20 behind it. But I just thought it was extraordinary when I just looked at this, which they were doing in the early 80s. And one of our photo mural sequences was this. so, you know, did we influence each other? Well, not consciously in any way, but we were using the memes that seemed to make sense. We were both using narrative. So it was big, we needed to use narrative to tell the story of what was going on. When we discussed with the people from Docklands how you describe what's going on in housing, they said, well, you can't really explain it unless you tell people why it's like that. You know, we need to explain the history, and therefore, you know, history and the narratives became central. And of course, we were all involved in active campaigning. And ours was in a cultural form, so there were fantastic things happened through the communities. I learned everything I know, I think, as an artist, from those activist communities that I've worked with. Who did extraordinary things, were able to make a difference, despite the fact it was we were under the worst right-wing government that has ever been known in the UK. I mean, this one's not is pretty bad, but Thatcher was pretty special in that way, in the sense that the damage she did then is still, we're still feeling the repercussions now. Yes, and I mentioned that we were work with health issues, so actually we both shared concern about very particular sort of issues at different times. So Karen Carl were doing this in 2000, we were doing this in the 70s, supporting, first of all, supporting our hospital closures. This was when we were beginning to put photographs together in a very basic way, in a montage. We didn't do the staging, but we were putting together photographs and whatever means we had. And also, you know, concern for, I think, issues. We were, feminist issues affected all of us. And we, I would say, it wasn't that the work was about women, but what we all did was address those real central concerns of feminism, which was about social and civic rights, striving for equality, redistribution, recognition, and also absolutely making things visible. Making visible the stories, the knowledge that people have at first hand that doesn't get into the public domain. And we were doing that. Apologies if I'm showing some of the same images that Doc, we didn't confer beforehand, but we have chosen some of the same images, even though actually there were hundreds and hundreds to choose from, as you know, right? We did actually work together once. Now, none of us normally works for galleries, but in 1991 there was a conference that was celebrating the 40th anniversary of the Kingston Conference, which was responsible for the first sort of public arts funding, as I understand it, in Canada. And we were invited to come and collaborate with these, all these guys probably said they wanted to work with us, and that's how we got to do it. But we came, Peter and I came and worked with Carol and Carl to develop a joint piece of work, which was in a gallery. Unfortunately, I wasn't here when it was launched. I was giving birth at the time. but It was in a gallery, and it was showing the deindustrialization that was going on in Canada, and it was showing the new digital highways, lines of communication, the global transfer of money that was happening, and that's an image of Canary Wharf, which became in Docklands the financial center, the new financial center of London, on top of the Tower of Babel, and the homelessness that was very rife in that period and still is.
And ours was referencing the deindustrialization. The photo, black and white in the background, was of the abandoned Ingalls plant when it closed down, and then different campaigns that went around that in t-shirts. And in the center there is a kitchen table, and we couldn't figure out how. We didn't want to put a mannequin in, because that's kind of, and we couldn't obviously hire someone to sit in the chair for however long it was up. So we actually made a chess pawn to put in the chair.
We were all looking for ways to get, as I said, to get people's voices out into the public domain through various means. So Karen Cole did all sorts of publications and exhibitions that went into workers' canteens and all over the place, also did billboards. After we'd finished the Docklands Community Poster Project, we carried on. We actually got funding because there was a very radical city council in London at the time called the Greater London Council that was abolished by the Thatcher government because it was so effective. It was very left-wing. It was absolutely vilified in the press. They had to abolish all of the metropolitan authorities in the country. That's all the city councils in the country, in order to get rid of the GLC, because it was so effective. And its leader was called Ken Livingstone, who became known as Red Ken. But when London got a mayor many years later, and the Labour Party wouldn't touch him because he was too left-wing, he stood as an independent and was voted back in. It was that effective. I won't even go into the... But it went through transport and women's committee. It funded the arts, £1 million a year into community arts and also into ethnic arts. And so what we did after that had finished, we still have billboards, we started to work with communities around other issues. And so perhaps where the work begins to diverge is that we were working less with trade unions at this time that were absolutely decimated under the Thatcher government, but we started to work more with local communities in East London around their issues, and issues that we spent 10 years on planning on the Docklands Community Poster Project, so we began to look at other issues, and also particularly work with young people. Occasionally, well, we were also shared, I think, the fact that the art world became completely uninterested, after we had all been under these right-wing governments, and we had the backlash for the young British artists in the UK, and nobody was interested. But actually, a few people, we carried on. We all just carried on and did what we did, because that's why we did it, for reasons other than our art. For art's sake, so it didn't matter. But occasionally people recognised what we did, and this was the first time the Tate Gallery ever, it was just one person in the Tate Gallery who decided to commission a community-based project, and we did it with a school in the Isle of Dogs in East London. But I put this in because actually, just to show that we both called on our artists of the past. We looked at because art is a very powerful medium. It has always celebrated, consolidated. It can do that for people other than those in power. And so we felt that by doing that with communities who didn't normally get their voice in the public domain, that actually we could give them that power. But the means that we use, I thought it would be interesting to put this in, weren't always dissimilar. And yes, they were different points of time, but to both calling on that art, also using this process of montage that we independently discovered. Although the difference was, I think, when Peter and I very early on embraced digital technology and couldn't believe it when these guys were producing things that were done as theatrical sets. I mean, this is just one, but there were hundreds of them, and you've seen ones in which even the captions are part of the set. When I first came and saw one of the sets, I was just amazed that they were able to produce this complex imagery. We were busy with Photoshop at the time, even in the early days, where you could make a cup of tea while you were processing each part of the image. But it was just, so there was that difference, although, of course, now they are the masters, mistresses, master and mistress of Photoshop. And also the other, I suppose, divergence is I became very interested in what the internet was going to be offering in terms of, I'd always worked with groups in a collaborative way, but actually then there was a chance to work with far more people, and I thought, what does it mean if you work with not just 20 people, but 1,000 children? How can you make something meaningful and coherent when so many people are contributing? And one thing that I discovered, and I think we talked about yesterday in one of the workshops, the importance of working from personal experience out to collective statement, if you like. And this was an experiment where I'd originally done it with a shared story, but then we did this as an online planet, a planet in cyberspace, virtual online cooperative environment, which I did in schools, because I did it in schools and it met the curriculum, it meant that teachers did it because they were able to use the technology that was being introduced that they didn't know how to do, and did it in four countries and with a lot of young people, and then also prior to the Olympics in London that offered very little is a bit of an understatement to the communities around there, particularly the young people, despite the hype of it all being won through the involvement of young people. They did nothing. And I thought, well, let's use the opportunity. And I worked with 400 teenagers in all sorts of groups, schools, colleges, support groups, referral groups, all sorts of groups, so that they created a guide to what they knew was good in East London for other young people. And so I did a lot of work with young people in that period. I'm sorry, you've already seen this one. But the other thing is that, of course, that we are now all, both working with the issues of the environment. And I've been working with older people now with a group called the Geezers on, as Don said, but on issues of tidal power. Not my decision, it was their decision that this was an area very important to be developed. And it started as a small commission, which I don't do small commissions really, but sometimes they're useful for starting something off, and then we just carry on and raise a bit more money and a bit more money and carry on. And so now we've been testing turbines in the Thames, and we're just about to launch a stream wheel in the Lower Lee Valley near the Thames, which is about driving an aerator to oxygenate the water so the fish don't die when the sewage goes into the river. This was another one recently with a floating marsh where the shored up banks of the River Thames don't give habitat for organisms. So even though the water's clean and the fish come back, there's nothing for them to eat. So we were experimenting with how you could grow reeds on the side of barges, moored barges, and then did projections on the embankment of the... I had to find the organisms, so very exciting. Science collaboration, looking through microscopes and discovering what the organisms were and then projecting them onto the sidewalk to heighten people's awareness of what was going on. And of course, the thing we shared with Carol and Carl wasn't just the art products, but it was their concern with funding, rights, policies. And I was privileged to be invited to give the keynote at the conference where the Ontario Arts Council had their first inaugurated their public funding of community arts, which these guys were very integral in sort of bringing about. That was because I was trying to remember when I last came, and I do remember now that it was about 9 years ago when Karen Cull helped me bring my retrospective exhibition, and thank you to A-Space for hosting it. So this was a fantastic place to show it. And now I just feel privileged to be here at the celebration of their work and their fantastic retrospective, which I saw yesterday. Anyway, thank you.
Not only did we have a close relationship with Loraine and Peter, and also Conrad Atkinson and Margaret Harrison in London, and we had close relationships with artists in Australia as well, particularly Ian Byrne, who was part of Art and Language in New York and then went to Australia and actually started working with trade unions and created the union media services and did various projects with unions in Australia. And through him, we met a number of artists who were working with Labour in Australia, and it was out of that that the some of the ideas for the Artists in the Workplace program here came out of the Australian, it had a different name, but anyway, basically having artists work in residence with trade unions. And that was inspired a lot by the Australian models. And also in the US, probably an important contact for us there was Alan Sepula. And we were in touch with him, met him originally in 76, and stayed in constant contact and knowledgeable about his work. So there was not only working within the local community, but there was a kind of international context within which a lot of this work was taking place.
I think there was one group that was left out that we were involved with, and Johanna made me think about the Women's Culture Building. So no one ever remembers that. We had shows in this, I mean, it was a great collective, met once a month and supported a great. So it's what you realize is, you know, we're sort of central at this point, but we're just part of a whole community of people who are struggling over different issues at different points. And that's what gives you the strength to carry on and do the work you do, is keeping that activity going and taking on these different fights. So I think Loraine has been doing it so many years, and the work that they were involved with allows us to feel comfortable doing the kind of work we do. So it, as more of it happens, it gives you comfort to take on the struggle that you are involved with. Thank you.
Leif Watson and Sanjit Dhillon are contemporary emerging curators, who have curated the contemporary response to Carolyn Carl's retrospective. So OCAD has actually helped support a response from contemporary artists in this. Their exhibition, entitled It's Still Privileged Art, 2016, poses to extend the dialogue of privilege and resistance to people of color, indigenous groups, the LGBTQ community, and people living on the margins. Presenting for both curators, please welcome Leeson Watson.
Very first symposium, so excuse the formality. Thank you. I think what has resonated with me from our speakers beginning today is that artists are instruments of oppression. That synopsizes everything that I've been working towards anyways. But I also think what's really important to add on to that is so are marginalized groups. Marginalized groups are also instruments of oppression. I became acquainted with Carolyn Carl's work in my talking community class that was conducted and instructed by OCAD's Jem and Sukli, which you've met. Sanjit and I were offered the opportunity to curate the contemporary response to Carolyn Carl's work, being that we found that their work and the themes that they were working with could be extended to the political climate and the social climate today. And of course, to satisfy my craving for curatorial experience, I said yes, not even knowing their work. So while I can remember the very first work I saw by Carol and Carl, I, like many of our speakers today, cannot speak to only one of them. It was two in particular that stood out to me. So the first image I read of and saw was It's Still Privileged Art, which I immediately gravitated to, but it was also this work, Art is Political. Being a millennial and a child of raised on Nirvana and anarchy, I found it really refreshing to see artists call out institutional imperialism, and I thought, I'm in love. So what better to do than curate the contemporary response to their work? So before I begin, I think it's very important to tell you who I am and what my practice is about. My practice often explores hegemony within Western semantics and contemporary culture by deconstructing semantics and hierarchical structures in Western discourse. I construct a narrative and vocabulary that allows marginalized groups to situate themselves in a place that they see fit. I am currently studying in the criticism and curatorial practice department here at OCAD U. So as you can tell, criticality and activism are very, very important to me. If our amazing art and social change program here at OCAD U has taught me anything, it has to be that change takes constant effort. I think it's very cliche when people will say that you need to be the change you want to see, but they never mention that you cannot be that change for only a day. You can't be that change for a week or a month. It has to be a constant effort. Time plays a key role in resistance. So with an art and activism spanning for 40 years, my co-curator and I found it so fascinating that Carolyn Carl's themes were still relevant today. My co-curator, Sanjit Dhillon, seated right over there, curated the contemporary response to their retrospective entitled It's Still Privileged Art. This piece featured on the slideshow right now is one of our key pieces that kind of helped us tie the works together. We found that I was particularly interested in how artists of color dealt with situating themselves in a social narrative that is also oppressive, as well as in showing their work in artistic institutions that never recognize their voices. I found that with every system of oppression, there are seeds of resistance. And without a doubt, Carol and Carl are artists for their people. So how I like to break up this discussion actually is the way in which I found the show that Sanjit and I curated to be unpacked. I found that spaces, traces, and erasures would be the best summary of all the themes that we wanted to focus on. So the exhibition that we curated extended the dialogue of privilege to people of color, LGBTQ community, and people living on the margins. We found that the equity and accessibility and privilege are not, it's not possible to separate those things from skin color, race, and sexuality. There is an incredible interconnectivity of both of those things. Artists, writers, and designers and curators have to take on the role as artist activists in the resistance against institutional, political, and cultural hierarchies. So in critiquing the role of power and privilege, artists reclaim their identities and subjectivities that were taken from them at birth. It's Still Privileged Art examines the way in which artists assess their positionality in the narrative of privilege within the Toronto art scene. As noted by Jacques Derrida, a person that I'm obsessed with, deconstructing oppositional binaries always exposes a trace. In the extension of this dialogue, we found that supremacy becomes a trace of reclamation as an inevitable non-meeting that is brought to mind with equality. One cannot discuss equality without thinking of supremacy. Thus, even in the absence of supremacy, does it still exist? So with an art practice that focuses on semantics, I thought I was very interested in the way the artists in our contemporary response use symbols to dismantle privilege and oppression. So let's start with erasures. This piece here by Carol and Carl is by far one of my favorite ones. I'm starting to look over their body of work. It's a series of colored photos entitled Signs, 1975, which features scenes of resistance that take shape in critical bodies or signs. The signs intrude the space but do not dominate. And they also desire to take up space, but also to dismantle and remind their viewers. This work itself blossoms into the work of Bijan Ramizani, who is in our contemporary response. His work, White Line, White Walls, White People, focuses on navigating and reclaiming his Iranian-Canadian identity in a post-9/11 Western society. Ramazani physically erases National Geographic's distorted representations of cultural identity. And I found what was really, really interesting was the words written on the sign aren't the raw material of imperialist art provided by the raw materials of oppressed cultures. And I thought, absolutely. And if Ramazani's work doesn't say that itself, Carolyn Carl's work absolutely does. The traces left from this erasure become indicative of the power of medial discourse. In the deconstruction, both artists construct. Through their erasures, the artists create a space for reconciliation as well as reclamation. Ramazani reclaims his space on the page by erasing distorted representations. Yet, even in this erasure, hegemony peeks through the white paint. The erased covers become blank signs that confront imperialism within these spaces. And again, supremacy becomes a trace of reclamation as the inevitable non-meaning that is brought to mind with equality. With every system of oppression, there are seeds of resistance. We also thought traces was very, very important because even in resistance, when you remember what you were fighting for and what you were advocating for, you always remember what you are fighting against. So even in establishing new social policies, you always remember what they were like before. Uses erasures to creep the absence presence of indigenous identity in the colonial narrative of Australian history. By photographing her body in a manner that is aesthetically similar to the archival and ethnographic imagery, her image's Queens crafts an alter narrative that subverts the colonial gaze. Indigenous women have involuntarily occupied archival imagery conducive to the colonial fantasy that transmits colonial notions and ideas of the noble savage, the exotic, and of the white Australian. She has explored archival imagery in the intent to decenter the colonial male gaze and to bring into question the ambiguous absence presence of the indigenous woman's body into the dominant Australian narrative. I also thought spaces, of course, is you need spaces to have resistance. You need spaces that are imperial to resist against. So spaces are very, very important. While creators use drawing and erasing, constructing and deconstructing to reclaim their spaces, their actions often become a cat and mouse game. The cyclical nature of covering and recovering is indicative of this pursuit of change. It takes constant effort. This piece right here is by one of our artists, Amy Wong, who constructed a thesis for her MFA that had excerpts and written blurbs and images and thoughts, and it completely rejected the standardized academic nature of most theses. When Sanjit and I received it, we thought, what is this? This is so interesting. This is an excerpt from one of them, and there's also this as well. In her rejection of standardized academic writing, Wong reclaims her space on the page. The subversion allows for the space and speculation and exploration, yet it confines chaos to a scholarly surface. Wong not only addresses what it means to live in the affluent west of the world, but what it also means to be the product of the internet. So to add on to Carolyn Carl's narrative of privilege, we are also adding on to the development of the technological world, as well as the age of the internet. The trace of institutional dominance, however, reveals itself in her use of the table of contents, footnotes, and indentations. It's Still Privilege Art marks and recognizes the push for constant change in the Toronto arts ecology. Black Indigenous artists of color are reclaiming their spaces and will not be silenced. It is to remember, though, with every system of oppression, there are seeds of resistance. And for every change, it takes constant effort. Thank you.